Happy New Year. It's great to see you all out. Obviously, you are the group that stayed safe, sane, and sober last night, all right? You are clear-minded and clear-eyed this early in the morning, so thank you so very much for being here. I did not stay up and watch the ball fall, all right? I was in bed. I did get up to let the dog in when all the fireworks went off, all right, in the neighborhood. And so I said good morning to a new year about 12:03 this morning. But glad you're here. Remember, it's 2017 now, all right? 2017. So as you fill out forms and sign checks, all right, remember, 2017. Welcome. If you are visiting with us today, thank you for starting the new year out at New Hope. We are honored by your presence today. There is a communication card in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to fill it out, put it in the offering bag as it comes by, and next week through the mail, we'll send you information that tells you about New Hope. We always promise not to beat on your door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail, send you information we hope will answer most of your questions about us. So we would love to get that information in your hands. Let me highlight several things. The beginning of a new year is always the kickoff of a lot of things. Actually, as you look around, you might see some people you don't recognize. That's because they're from the 8 o'clock service. All right, and they're slumming in the 9:15 service today. I mean 9:30 service today. So you may introduce yourself to somebody you think's a visitor. That's okay. All right, they're just a new friend you're going to meet that you might not have had a chance to meet otherwise. Let me get the sign up clipboard going around, which we haven't had in a couple of weeks. This is for Women's Tuesday Night Bible Study, which is going to start January 10th, a week from this Tuesday night. All right, not this week, but a week from Tuesday night. They're going to be doing a study called Experiencing Contagious Joy, and they want to be sure to have enough material. This is at 6:45 on Tuesday evenings, so if you would just sign up with your contact information there, they would appreciate that very much, and I believe that is the only sign-up sheet we've got. So, Wednesday, I'll hand that back to me here. Let me say it again then. So you have Tuesday nights, and then a few pages back. Thank you, Fawn. Glad you're feeling better, Fawn. Good to see you. There's the Wednesday morning Bible study, which is going to be the study of Acts, led by Diana Rood, and that starts on January the 11th. That's a Wednesday morning. So Tuesday night and Wednesday morning women's Bible studies are on the clipboard. So please sign up if you're going to be attending. You cannot attend the women's Bible study, Chick. And I'm getting to that one. All right, thank you very much. They don't have a clipboard. So I wasn't talking about them yet. Since Dick brought it up, Tuesday night, starting that same night of the 10th, the men's Tuesday night Bible study picks back up, and they are in the book of Acts, if I believe. Is that correct, Mr. Addis? All right, very good. So they'll pick that study up. There is an all-church skate night. Okay, there's an all-church skate night, so none of you are too old to attend. You might not skate. The liability is not ours if you do, okay? But you could go and watch. Great time of fellowship. Shelly and I'll probably skate, all right? It's always a fun adventure, but it's a great time to meet other folks from our church, enjoy some of the younger families with their children, and that is going to be on January the 5th. If you are the parent of junior high or high school kids, there is going to be a parent meeting next Sunday afternoon, right after the last service at 12:30. It's probably going to be about a 45-minute meeting, so Chris would love to see all the parents of our junior high and high school kids. January will be no exception to the second Tuesday luncheon for our seniors, all right? So 55 or older. Come on out and join a great lunch on January the 10th. Sounds like January the 10th is going to be a busy day. Men, women's Bible study and lunches all kicking off that day. All right, there is a new movie coming out January the 21st called The Resurrection of Gavin Stone. Fawn and Tim Boss went to see the premiere. They give it a very high big thumbs up, double thumbs up, and so we're going to start having tickets available. We'll tell you more about it. You can Google that name, The Resurrection of Gavin Stone, get some updated information, but we'll talk more about that next Sunday. We do want to get that on your calendar. It's not a women's event exclusively. Men are invited. It's going to be a great movie to invite a friend or a neighbor just to come and enjoy a day together. We're going to have the whole theater to ourselves. Well, at least one of the theater rooms at the theater, all right? So come and join us for a great morning out. I think those are the announcements that I need to highlight today, but I do have several prayer requests and updates that I need to bring to your attention. First off, Bernice Osborne's daughter, you've been praying for several months now, going through treatment, and everything is still progressing for doing a bone marrow transplant on the 20th of this month. They leave Tuesday and will be up there from this Tuesday, I believe, until the 20th. There's several things that has to be done in preparation for that day. So please continue to pray for Charlene. They would appreciate that so very, very much. Bob Anear from our own congregation, he's having an oblation done on Tuesday, all right, at the Heart Hospital. So be praying for Bob as he goes in for that. Larry Baumeister, who's been in the hospital for the last 11, 12 days, was comatose, all right, not responsive on Christmas Eve. When I prayed with him and his wife in the ICU there at Clovis Community Hospital on Christmas Eve, I told him during that prayer that my Christmas present would be when I come back to see him Christmas Day, that he was looking at me and talking to me. Well, when I came back Christmas Day afternoon after church on Sunday and I went in there, he looked at me, and he was talking to somebody. And so I told him, I said, Larry, I didn't say who you had to be talking to. I just said that you were talking. He was preoccupied about a 4x4, a boat, and a lake. And we have no idea who he was having this speech with, but Rose and I sat and listened to it. When I did get his attention and ask a specific question about how he felt, he said, my foot hurts. So anyway, he is recuperating from meningitis and double pneumonia. And I saw him then the middle of the week, and he has improved. He's out of ICU. He's in a regular room. They hope by Tuesday or Wednesday that he will be going home with some health care aides assisting for a week or two. But he has improved considerably, and we are very grateful for that. So please continue to pray for Larry Baumeister. Doug had his procedure. We talked about Bropes this past last Sunday. He is home. The procedure went well. That was that dental floss procedure I told you about. I won't explain it again. it had nothing to do with his teeth, all right? But that went well. He was doing pretty good, but he's not feeling well today. So if you would remember to pray for Doug, he lives in Southern California. I know the Bropes family would appreciate that. Dad's not here this morning. The cold he had in his head has now dropped to his chest. Just found that out before we started, so please be praying for Dad as well. Nanette Knight, I have not got an update on her knee surgery, but she was in the hospital and then was to leave there for a care facility till surgery decisions could be made. Continue to pray for my cousin Debbie. She continues to struggle. Jordan Paulsgraf had her surgery this past week. That's our high school student, and she got an infection at the surgery site. So the surgery went well, but there have been some complications since then. Pat Williams' daughter, Sue Williams, is going to be having her first of a few surgeries for breast cancer this week and would appreciate your prayers for her. The Enzo Fernando family, that's the young man from Clovis West who took his own life a few weeks ago. That service was here this past week. What a delightful family. I would appreciate you remembering the Fernando family. He is an ER surgeon, and she works out of his office, so I would appreciate you remembering both of them. He was born in the Philippines. She was born in Great Britain. This young man, for being 17 years old, has traveled the world. He's given me a new thing on a bucket list now. When he was 6 years old, he walked up to his mother and said, "You lied to me." She said, "Well, son, I've never lied to you. Yet there's no Santa Claus." And she was living in England at the time, taking care of her dad, who was very, very ill. The following day, her husband arrived from the States. They went back and forth every 6 weeks during school breaks. And so she told her husband, "Our son, he's only six, and he doesn't believe in Santa Claus. We have to do something about this." So the next day, they got on a plane and went to Lapland, Finland. Did you know there is a year-round Santa's Village in Lapland? You've been there? To Lapland Finish. That is so cool. That is one of the most awesome. I went online, I Googled it, I looked at the YouTube. Man, I mean, Santa, he's there. The reindeers, they're there. And so they took their six-year-old, and so he believed for two more years. All right? They extended his faith just a little bit longer. But we had probably 120 students here, all right, from Clovis West that day. So please just be praying for the family and for those kids and for their recoveries. Bobby Bourne, Jim Bourne, who's here in the service, his mom passed away this last week. Her service is going to be here Thursday morning at 10 o'clock. Got a long, rich history with the Bourne family, and it started with the death of her husband 24 years ago. And that's a story I'll share with you again someday, but just be praying for the Bourne family, and she is home with the Lord. I had a chance to get a wonderful hug from her the night before she passed away the next morning, and the day before when I went to see her and I walked in, or 2 days before when I walked in, she said, "I just love to see you." I said, "Man, I wish more people thought that way," all right, and but anyway, Bobby's going to give me some wonderful, wonderful memories. Larry Gallant, a former member of New Hope, has been worshiping for the last several years up in Shaver Lake at the church at Shaver Lake, former elder board member here at the church. He also passed away this last week, and his service is going to be next Sunday afternoon at 1:30 up in Shaver Lake. And so if you would remember the Gallant family, I'm sure they would appreciate. Kent Millar's service is going to be here on Saturday at noon. And so I would appreciate you remembering to pray for them as well. And Friday, there's a service, not here, but at Clovis Funeral Chapel for the mother of Brian Smart, all right, the Smart brothers. If you know about Holiday Pools, Dreamscape Pools, and there's a third one, all three brothers have their own pool company. If you would just be remembering to pray for that family, I know they would appreciate it. So those are the updates on prayer requests that we wanted to share with you. At this time, I'm going to ask our ushers to come and prepare to wait on us. You have your first opportunity to give to the kingdom work in 2017. All right, 2017. So thank you so very much. Looky here. We have two couples waiting on us today. All right. The men are going to cover the exits, and the ladies are going to take care of the center aisle. Thank you very much, Berniers and Friesens, for waiting on us today. Let's pray. Our Father, we love you. We thank you for all that you have done in our lives and through our lives and for our lives in 2016. It is with great expectation and hope and faith that we enter 2017. 2017 is uncharted waters for us. We can look back at 2016 and we can learn from our mistakes. We can grow from our dependence upon you. And we can rejoice about what you were sufficient in our lives when we gave you freedom to reign and rule in our lives, our actions, and our attitudes. And Father, I trust we'll take the good as well as the bad. We'll reflect on it, we'll learn from it, and then, Father, we will say 2016 is now finished, and 2017 is ahead of us, and we will trust you for what it is that you want to do. Father, I hope there will be growth and maturity and an expansion of your access to our world, and that we can say at the end of 2017, we have grown in our walk and our fellowship with you. Father, we trust you for the needs. We've talked about so many already this morning, surgeries and treatments, and we trust them all to you. For those in need of comfort because of loss, there's been so many during this season, and so we trust their needs to you as well. Father, thank you for the privilege of giving today. We're so grateful for those who gave to New Hope over this past year. It's the largest it's ever been. And Father, we've also given away more than we ever have, and we say thanks just to see your kingdom grow and your kingdom advance and your influence increase in the world. Thank you for that privilege. And I trust in 2017 we won't sit back and look with contentment on 2016, but with great expectation say, Lord, what do you want to do now? So for all of this, we give you thanks. In the awesome, incredible, strong name of Christ we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you for being here for the first Sunday of 2017. And we're going to take a little bit of time this morning to reflect back. And I'm also going to ask for your help as we do this one more Sunday next week. If you have a less more story from what we've been doing for the entire past year, if you're new, you get a pass, all right? But if you remember this time last year, we started a series called The Less More Lifestyle. How many of you still have that little piece of paper in your Bible that you got a year? Oh, you're pulling them out. Good, terrific. You are the perfect candidates to send me a story, all right? Just tell me how you did with that less more. Look at it, reflect on it from this Sunday for a day or two, and then send me email. You know my email. It's tim@newhopechurch.net. It's on the bulletin. Send me your story. Hey, how did it look, all right, from last year to this year in the area in which God said, here's where I want to work in your life. I want less of you in this area and more of me in this part of your life. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to highlight a little bit of some of the things we talked about on this Sunday last year, and then encourage you in a new way to let's have a fresh start. Let's not stop the less more lifestyle, just though the series is going to end, but let's continue in God. What areas of my life do you want less of me and more of you to be functioning in? For many of us, New Year's resolutions seem to resemble carbon dating. Carbon dating is where you just kind of pick and choose what year based on what you found. All right? We adjust what we found and the year to where we'd like it to be. And so sometimes what we do is we cut in half lives from one year to the next of our resolutions. Here's an example of what I'm talking about. Let's say in 2011, one of your resolutions was, I will read at least 10 books this year. 2012 comes along and you failed. And so you say, I will read 5 books this year. And then 2013 comes around and you failed the previous year, so you say, I will finish War and Peace before the next year. 2014 comes around and you say, you know what? I think I will read some articles out of the newspaper this year. We have two editors over there that would make them very happy if more people read articles out of the newspaper. 2015 rolls around and says, I will read at least one article somewhere this year. And in 2016, you said, I will try and finish the comics before the year is over. That's sort of the way we adjust, all right, to things. Or maybe for those of us who are challenged with our health and weight at the beginning of every year. That's when I start to meddle, okay? It goes kind of like this. 2004, I will follow my new diet religiously until I get under 200 pounds. 2005 comes around, I will try to develop a realistic attitude about my weight. 2006, I will work out 5 days a week. 2007, I will work out 3 days a week. 2008, I will try to drive past a gym at least once a week. All right. We adjust based upon previous year's failures. Somebody once said, I made six resolutions last year and I kept them all year. They're in an envelope on top of the filing cabinet. Yeah. We have a lot of fun with resolutions at the beginning of the year. I'm going to make the promise to lose the same 18 pounds I've lost the previous four years. I have lost them every year. I really have. And somewhere between the end of September and the beginning of December, I find them all again. And we start the process over. We love new things. We love a new year. We love a new car. We love a new home. We love new clothes, a new job. There's something fresh and exciting about new. And I wonder if we've ever realized that every day we wake up and our feet hits the floor, it's new. Today is new. It's a fresh start and a new beginning. It's a day that's never been worn. It's never been stepped on. It's never been used. I think I said this last year, it's kind of like a baby's bottom fresh out of the womb. It's never been wiped, powdered, or probed, and the doctor can't wait to give it a swat. You and I need to look at every fresh new day and can't wait to give it a run for its money. I think January 1st, and it just happens to be the first day of the week this year, January 1st is perhaps one of the best of new days because it marks the beginning of a journey, not just a new day, but a new year, 365 fresh new days. And it's a time that we begin to think, how am I going to begin the dawning day of a new year better than I ended the final day of an old year? I don't know how your day ended yesterday, but don't you hope that today is even better? I don't care how good yesterday was, we all should wake up with an expectation and anticipation that this is the day the Lord has made, and because He made it for me, it will be better than my yesterdays. It seems to me that resolutions or determinations or intentions, whatever we want to call them, or at least our thoughts about something fresh and new needs to center around those two words, less, more. The things we looked at last year were less debt, more savings, less weight, more shape. Do you remember what I said on this Sunday last year about shape? Round is a shape. Yes, you remembered. Yeah, round is a shape. We want less sickness and more health. We want less clutter, more space, less, here's one I've added. I want less work, more rest. Told Shelley yesterday, physically I feel good. Spiritually, it's been a sweet year with Jesus. Mentally, I'm fatigued. If I call you by a wrong name today, sorry about that. If I think you're younger than what you really are, just play with me on that one, all right? If I think you're older than you really are, just don't get mad at me, all right? I'm looking for better ways to live and the rest that God has for us in spite of the busyness of what life may bring to us. Today I want all of us, now that we've had a year to live with this thought process of less and more, to think about more of Jesus and less of me. John the Baptist was the first one, I think, to really grasp this principle and put it into words in the Scripture. When in John chapter 3, verses 29 through 30, remember John the Baptist, the cousin of Jesus, the forerunner to the ministry of Jesus. Jesus is about ready to step into the public arena. John's already been there for a few years, letting folks know he was like the Billy Graham of his generation, man. If he set up a podium somewhere and began to preach, the crowds came. They would leave the city when the rumors, hey, John's going to preach out in the wilderness. They would leave the city and go to hear what this guy dressed in crazy clothing and long hair who had a peculiar diet. They couldn't wait to hear what he was going to say. He was extremely popular. And yet, at the height of his popularity, he didn't worry about it. In fact, here is what he said. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. And the friend who attends the bridegroom, the best man, he waits and he listens for him and he's full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. And John said, the joy is mine. My task is now complete. He, Jesus, must become greater. He must become more. And I must become less. Paul amplified on that same principle in Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, when he said, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but it's Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. That tense in which Paul wrote that, I have been, it's a tense which literally goes, I have been and I need to continue to be crucified with Christ, so that daily there is less of me and more of Him being evidenced in my life. And what does this look like for you and me in 21st century living? How is it expressed and experienced? Let's make a few comparisons, and I'll be anxious to hear from some of you this week. What were the things God probed your heart to say? This is an area
that I want to work more in your life in, so there's less of you and more of me. Here was a partial list that we looked at last year just to get you thinking. I want to be a person who has less doubt and more trust. And remember, trust in God is evidenced by our obedience to God. Without obedience to Him, we cannot say we trust Him. It is only on the basis of obedience that trust is expressed. I want less worry, more peace. I want less stuff and more ministry. I want less TV and more time with family and friends. And maybe I should say, I want less video games, more time with family and friends. I want less newspapers and novels, and I want more scripture. Less regrets, more contentment, less silence, more witnessing, less fear, more courage, less selfishness, more generosity, less anger, more love, less complaining, more praying, less foolishness, more wisdom. In the last few days, I've extended that list a bit. Less judgment, more grace. How quick are we to look at somebody who's a bit different than we are? Hey, I made a bonehead mistake a couple of weeks ago. I looked at a guy all tatted up. I know some of you have tats. Not opposed to them. I'm just a coward. His dress was not my style. And I made a snap judgment in my thinking. And within about 2 minutes of a conversation with him, I found out here is a man who has a strong faith in Jesus and was walking in righteousness. We need to be less judgmental and more grace-filled. I need to have less tolerance of sin and more acceptance of sinners. Okay, listen to that one, okay? I need to have less tolerance. We've become a church. We've become silent on so many issues, and that's not good for the kingdom work. And we've excused our silence as being tolerance, and no, it's not. That's cowardness. Okay? The things which the Bible calls sin still need to be identified as sin. But remember, every single one of us have been sinners. Okay? And so we need grace to work with sinners in their sin, but we don't do sinners a favor when we try to say that maybe the choices, the decisions they're making are not sin, but they're okay. See, we never pull people out of sin by condoning sinfulness. We need less fear of dying. You're going to hear this a lot this coming year. We need to be less afraid as believers of dying. And we need to be more excited about going to heaven. That doesn't mean we want to rush the process. That doesn't mean we want to be in a hurry. Okay? But we should not be afraid. We should not be afraid, as they used to sing in some of the old hymns of the church, crossing over Jordan. Crossing over Jordan was going from the desert to the promised land, folks. So crossing over Jordan as a picture of going to heaven is a good thing. It's getting all the promise. So whether it comes young or old, that should not be anything that we are afraid of. Doesn't mean there aren't some sadness connected with that, all right? When the day comes and I retire, isn't that a great day? I mean, those of you who've retired, isn't retirement pretty cool? So I've been told, okay? So that's going to be a great day, but it's going to come with some sadness, okay? Because things are going to change. Things are going to be different, but it also ought to be met with great expectation. And the idea of dying for believers, because that's a great time of witnessing our faith to others who don't have that hope, who don't have that assurance. And so it's a great time for them to discover what peace with God is all about. We need less timidity in sharing our faith, and we need more courage to be bold. And I'm not talking about sharing religion. I'm talking about sharing our relationship with Jesus Christ. Man, well, we're going to have babies and we're going to have grandchildren. Don't we get excited about telling other people about our babies and our grandchildren? Shouldn't we also be excited about folks who could be birthed again? newborn babes in Christ. We need less acceptance of mediocrity and a greater pursuit of excellence. As the King's kids, we ought to want the King to be seen in the way in which we do everything that we do. We need less decision-making on feelings, and we need greater dependence upon truth. As we make decisions, we need to make decisions not on how I feel about something, but on what does God say about something. Because there are times, folks, I got to be honest, I have some feelings that aren't very good. Okay? And we often say, well, no, I shouldn't. I mean, have you ever felt like hitting somebody? Okay. I have. Never Shelly. But I've she hits back. Yeah. She's had Taekwondo training, all right? No, but I'll be out there, but times has the thought ever crossed your mind quickly, fleetingly? I could just kill somebody. You've been angry? We probably have. An alcoholic, I want another drink. An addict, I want another hit. I just want to make myself happy. And we think these short-term feelings are going to do that for us, and yet we find out that once we've done those things, it didn't bring the happiness that we thought it would. And so why don't we decide to make decisions based on truth rather than emotion? I think we'll find ourselves in greater place of contentment. Less blank and more prayer. I don't know what it is that takes so much of your time. I could tell you what takes my time, but what can we do less of so that we can pray more? There's a lot of churches around the entire country that take 21 days of prayer and fasting. We talked about this last year, and many of you did it. And that's going to start again January the 9th, a week from tomorrow. There's going to be members of congregations all around the communities of Fresno and Clovis and all over the country, actually, literally around the world. This is a movement that started a few years ago. And I would encourage you, why don't you consider jumping on that bandwagon with others of us and considering for 21 days, I'm going to spend this amount of time daily in prayer, and I'm going to fast from something. Fasting, I know, is a thing that has become passe and old-fashioned, and some say, Tim, I don't even know what fasting is. Well, biblical fasting always has to do with eliminating some distractions for a spiritual purpose. It kind of hits the reset button of our soul, and it renews us from the inside out. Remember, your personal fast should present a level of challenge for you. If you're going to fast from something, it ought to be something that is a bit more difficult. It's one thing to say I'm going to exercise than it is to say I'm going to work out. See, a casual walk around the block could be exercise. And for some, that might be a heavy workout because you haven't done that in a long time. But we really need to push ourselves. The old philosophy, no pain, no gain, there has to be a wee bit of pain in this process for us to really consider it fasting. It's very important to know your body, your options, and most importantly, seek God in prayer and follow the Holy Spirit. There are four types, maybe more, but four I'll highlight real quick, types of fast. One is a complete fast. This fast calls for drinking only liquids for 21 days, water and light juices. For many of you, that would not be a healthy thing to do, okay? And it might push the limits for you, but some can do it just fine. Number two is a selective fast. This involves I'm going to eliminate certain things from my diet for the next 21 days. And you know what? If you hate peas, don't say, okay, for the next 21 days, I'm not going to eat peas. See, that would be an easy fast for me, okay? Because for the next 365 days, I am not going to eat peas. One example of a selective fast is the Daniel fast that some of you have heard about. It's the time in which you remove meat, sweets, and bread from your diet, and you consume just water, juices, fruits, and vegetables. All right? And so you do that for 21 days. Man, I am a meat lover. For me to say I am not going to eat meat for 21 days, that would be a challenge for me, because I've been known to sit down in a few places and think to myself out loud, where's the meat? Eh? Because I like meat. Then there's a partial fast, and this is called or referred to some by some as the Jewish fast. It involves abstaining from eating any kind of food for a period of time every day. Usually it's breakfast and lunch. So from the time you get up in the morning until dinner in the evening, you don't eat, and you have just one meal a day. And then there's what's called the soul fast. The fast is common for those who've not had much experience of fasting with food, and maybe you have health issues that prevent you from doing that, or you want to focus on a certain area of your life that's out of balance. Someone might select to abstain from using social media. I've heard people, Shelley for a period of time, stayed off of Facebook, all right, for an extended period of time. You may choose to stay off of the television or, you know, computer games, and then choose carefully to bring that element back in your life in an orderly fashion at the conclusion of the fast. There are references of fasting that you can look up on your own in the Bible in Matthew chapter 6, Matthew chapter 9, Luke chapter 18, Acts chapter 27, Nehemiah chapter 9, all scripture references you can go to look about the fast. Last year, as we looked at the series of the Less More Lifestyle, we said there were four steps important so that this was not another broken resolution at the end of the year. This process starts with what? Choice, thank you. This is more important than desire. You may have a desire bigger to do something else, but choose to do what is right. This continues with what? Consistency. Being consistent in good habits of prayer, Bible study, scripture memory, worship. It is maintained by accountability. Yeah, choice, consistency, then maintained by accountability. Tell others of your desire and your choice. Tell your family, tell your friends, tell your coworkers, tell your small group members, and ask them to hold you accountable to this. Then it is advanced by contemplation. That word that most of us didn't know a year ago, which means profound thinking. The state of beholding God and our union with God. In Christianity, it refers to a mind that is directed towards the awareness of God as a living reality, the practice of that slow, thoughtful, savoring reading of Bible verses. And that is the reason that we spent all last year preaching through the Psalms, except for the month of October. And we looked at a lot of different subjects in the psalm, if you'll recall, through the past year. We looked at the grind of compromise and the problems of uncertainty. And what about those seasons in your life when God seems to be quiet, when He's silent? How do we handle worry? And man, how do we put up with difficult people? How do we stop our faith from being a ritual religion? How do we deal with sorrow and grief and impatient arrogance? We looked at the problems of laziness and imbalance in our lives and a lifestyle that displeases God. We looked at other subjects like worship and obedience and struggles and death and the will of God and how do we get revived and refreshed. We all have those days when small problems become crises, when doubt begins to overwhelm our faith, when exhaustion hits and depression colors our world dark. Fact is, the daily grind of life is not going to go away in 2017. It's going to still be here. And the book of Psalms is a great place for you to go back to again and again, because there you will find answers. You'll find words that are going to surpass our problems of weakness and offer to us comfort during the difficult and demanding times of 2017. This morning, the good news is, according to Isaiah 43:18, the Lord says, "Forget about what has happened before. Do not think any more about the past. Instead, look at the new things that I'm going to do." Do you hear what God is saying in that verse? Forget what's happened in 2016. He says, don't think about the past. The book is closed on that year. Now I've got a fresh start for you. Let's take that word start for just a quick moment and see if I can give you some direction for this coming year. S-T-A-R-T. Stop making excuses. If you want a fresh start in life, stop making excuses. Proverbs 28:13 says, a man who refuses, and we could say a woman as well, who refuses to admit their mistakes will never be successful. But if we confess and forsake them, we get, listen to this, the wise man said, we get another chance. We get another chance. T, take an inventory of our lives. Be honest. Assess where we are. I need to evaluate all my experiences. Look at what I have left after, look what I have left after failure. I need to take an inventory of the experiences and learn from them. Paul said in Galatians 3:4, you have experienced many things. Were all these experiences wasted? I hope not. The Living Bible says it this way, you suffered so much for the gospel, now you're going to throw it all overboard? Failure does not have to be our enemy or our foe. Failure can be our friend. A, act in faith. This is the third step. Launch into new territory. The Bible says the key to changing anything is faith. Matthew 9 says, according to your faith, it will be done to you. This is not about our work. It is about our faith in Christ. A very simple statement, yet it's very, very powerful. R, refocus our thoughts. If our life needs to be changed, we have to refocus our thoughts. If I want to get going again and have a fresh start, I need to rethink the way that I think. I need to change my mind, possibly, about some issues. Proverbs 4:23 says, be careful how you think. Our life is shaped by our thoughts. Notice, how we think shapes our lives, not how we feel. How we feel produces consequences. How we think shapes and molds. The second T, trust. Trust God for His success in our life. Depend on Him, not on ourselves. Zechariah 4:6 says, we will not succeed by our own strength or power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. There was an article a few years ago in which a man gave his idea of a perfect world. He said, in a perfect world, we would feel as good at 60 as we did at 17. And we would be as smart at 60 as we thought we were at 17. In a perfect world, professional basketball and baseball and football players would be complaining because school teachers were signing multi-million dollar contracts. Where are all my teachers? I expected an amen on that one. Okay? In a perfect world, potato chips would have calories, but if eaten with dip, the calories would be neutralized. In a perfect world, mail would always be early, and the check in the mail would always be for more than we expected it to be. The truth is, this is not a perfect world, and it never will be, but it can become a lot better in this new year for all of us if we will get a fresh start, S-T-A-R-T. Let me wrap this up. Somebody wrote this, I am the new year. I am the new year. I'm an unspoiled page in your book of time. I am your next chance at the art of living. I am your opportunity to practice what you have learned about life during the last 12 months. All that you sought and didn't find is hidden in me, waiting for you to search it, but with more determination. All the good that you tried for and didn't achieve is mine to grant when you have fewer conflicting desires. All that you dreamed but didn't dare to do, all that you hoped but did not will, all the faith that you claimed but did not have, these slumber lightly, waiting to be awakened by the touch of a strong purpose. I am your opportunity to renew your allegiance to me, the one who said, behold, I make all things new. You want to start this new year right? Started in full surrender to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Today's the day, not tomorrow. And don't live off your yesterdays. Today is the day. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we love you. We thank you for your incredible love for us. We thank that you promise us new strength, new hope, fresh joy every single day. We don't have to live off of leftovers with you. Your faith, your hope, your joy, your love It's never stale because it's new every morning. That's your promise to us. And so if we are living a stale life, it's because we're living off of yesterday instead of living off of you today. Remind us, direct our attention, Father, to what areas of less and more that you want to accomplish in our lives. Father, I can't wait to read some testimonies of those who are going to share a little bit with me in the coming week about how there's less of them and more of you in this area of their life because of their commitment to you this past year. Thank you for the hope that will instill in the rest of us. We love you. May we have a fresh start today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day. I would say I'll see you next year, but I'll see you next week.